Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Vice Chair Commissioner Bill Ashley had his scheduled surgery this morning. It's over, and he's resting, and apparently is in pretty good spirits. I say that, so if you would keep him in your prayers. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we again come before you to do the business of this county. Much continues to happen that we don't understand. Another national shooting today. We ask ourselves why. We ask why we have such dissension, lack of unity in this country, in this state, and in this county. We ask that you give guidance and support to those who are detractors and provide them the light that they may too see the progress and the potential we have in this county and in this world. We ask that you keep Bill Ashley and his family close, provide him the strength that he may heal and heal quickly and rejoin this board. And all these things we pray. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, everyone. We'll call this the second meeting of September 2013, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners to order. You'll see we have a quorum, but just barely. I do want to report that Bill Ashley is in the hospital as we speak in Durham, recovering from heart surgery. His wife called a couple of people today, indicate that everything went as planned. In addition, Tim Sutton, who is his day job is a driver's ed teacher in Guilford County, and this evening is his first meeting with his students in the written part, where everybody gets in the gym and gets to talk, and he just really felt uncomfortable not being there, to which I certainly understand. So he did give me input on several of the items that we'll be discussing tonight, and sends his regrets for not being in attendance. This time we have two public comment speakers. I'd first like to call on Tony Cox. Mr. Cox, welcome, sir.
Thank you. How y'all doing tonight?
And I'd like to wish Bill Ashley Godspeed in his recoveries. For some reason or another in this country, people are around here and they've got problems just like everywhere else. It seems like people don't like to see other people do good. People try to do good, but they don't. I don't know. It's just like, you can't do better than me. And you got neighbors out there that want to run them and theirs liberal, but with others conservative. But yet, people want to call and get government involved in things that could be settled amongst people. And when the government's called in, it's like with the Syria deal over here. We know who the bully on the block is. It's government. Everybody says government's the bully. Government's the bully. Government's the bully. We want good government. People in the county, they need money. They need raises. Everybody needs this. Everybody needs that. We need jobs. People are trying to do better. Can't get a job. Especially convicted felons, your hope is that you have a trade that you can do. Because everybody wants to see a convicted felon this and a convicted felon that. And use your past criminal history against you. And other small things. I heard the other day Dick Cheney said that he got thrown out of, it was Yale or Harvard, twice and got two DUIs before he was 21, I believe it was.
But he said Donald Rumsfeld gave him a break under Gerald Ford. You start looking at history, look at more than one side, look at all sides. Look at the side under the law, not coulda, woulda, shoulda, did, didn't. Because later on down the road, it might come back and show you that, you know what, I made a fool out of myself. And you know, sometimes it's hard to say, I messed up. Sometimes it's hard to say, I'm sorry. But you know, I know I've had to do it. I've had to do it in the courtroom, but it's just gotten crazy. We need governance. We need our elected officials to support the people. Do your job and follow the law. You said that in a newspaper article in 2006, Mr. Smith. Do your job and follow the law. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. I'd like to now call on Tanya. Tanya, help me with your last name.
Jisa.
Welcome, Tanya.
Thank you.
Wants to speak on the Benevolence Farm nonprofit event.
Yes. Good evening. My name is Tanya Jisa.
Hey, Tanya.
Glad to be here tonight and share with you a little bit about Benevolence Farm, which is a nonprofit that is creating a program in Alamance County. We're going to be located in Southern Graham on 11 acres of property that has been donated to the program. And we will serve women who are returning to the community from prison. We'll provide them housing and employment on the farm, and they'll live and work there for up to 2 years. There are about 2,600 women who come out of North Carolina prisons each year, and 88 of those returned to Alamance County last year. And so we are going to provide opportunities for these women who have many obstacles in their path, as been alluded to a little bit earlier this evening, and provide them with a second chance to become successful contributing citizens of North Carolina. Along that same vein, I wanted to invite you all to the Second Chance Dine and Dance, which is going to be our first annual benefit. It's going to be at the Hall River Ballroom on October 10th, and we'll have dancing and food, and we'll hear from some of the women in North Carolina who have returned and are now supporting programs like Benevolence Farm. And I have some information that I can share with you all in print, if that would be helpful, and I thank you so much for allowing me to be here tonight.
Thank you. And do you have your contact information that maybe you could give to
I absolutely do. And, yes, it's on the back of the
we can distribute right that there, as well, yes, in case there are questions from
sure
others.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Following the public comment period, are there any commissioner responses at this time? Hearing none, the next item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. Let me first ask Mr. Honeycutt, I know that we are not now going into closed session, is that correct? So that item
yes,
will be pulled.
Yes, sir.
And do you have any other changes to the agenda?
No, sir.
Okay. Looking at the agenda, there are three items on consent. Is there any commissioner that would like to pull any item from consent? Hearing none, we'll entertain a motion to approve the agenda as presented, with the exception of removing item number 11. Looks like there's two item number 11s. The first item number 11, we'll call that 11A, is removed about going into closed session. And with that motion, it would include the three items on the consent agenda. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Any other discussion about the agenda? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Agenda is approved. Thank you. Next item on our agenda is the public hearing for the Rural Operating Assistance Program funds, also known as the ROPE funds. I know Jason is here and Dennis is here. Jason, you want to start us out?
Sure.
Welcome.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packets a packet of information regarding the Rural Operating Assistance Program funding for fiscal year 2013-2014. As part of the application process, the county must hold a public hearing regarding the use of the funds for this program. The county is scheduled to receive $313,017 in funding this year, which is split between three programs, the Elderly and Disabled Assistance Program, EDTAP, the Employment Work First Program, and the Rural General Public Program. Also included in your packet is the sub-allocation worksheet, which shows each portion of that funding, what the amount is, and then a proposed sub-allocation for solely the EDTAP funding, and that is at the back of the packet. With that, I'll be glad to take any questions that you all have at this time, and Dennis Williams from ACTA is here as well to answer questions.
Jason, thank you. This yes, is a public hearing, so perhaps we should see if there are any speakers, and then if you could stay up for expertise and answers. Let me see if there is a motion that we conduct a public hearing at this time. Do we hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We do have a public hearing in session now for the consideration and discussion of the Rural Operating Assistant Program funds. Do we have any speakers from our audience that would like to address this issue? Hearing none, we'll entertain a motion to close the public hearing. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Now, would you or Dennis like to make any other comments, or does anyone have any questions for Jason or Dennis? Dennis is our Executive Director of ACTA. Dennis, welcome to you.
Thank you. I have really nothing else to add.
I call the question.
Okay, the question has been called for approval of the budget as presented for the Rural Operating Assistance Program. When you call the question, does that include making a motion for approval? Is there a second?
So moved.
Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Any opposed? I didn't hear you say aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you, Dennis. Next item seven is the DSS board appointment. The commissioners are charged with reviewing and appointing individuals from our county on various boards, and some are up for renewal periodically. There is a vacancy on the DSS board, in that the current and soon to be former chair, Susan, correct me if I'm wrong, but David Carter has served the maximum amount of time that he can before he has to step down for at least a 12-month period. His position is appointed by this board, and we do have several applicants. Commissioner Linda Massey serves on the DSS board and is very close to the organization. At this time, I'd like to ask her to comment on this process.
Well, I've only had... I know there are three applicants. I've only had one that has discussed it with me. So I guess at this time, I would like to make a motion that David Sproul be on the DSS board.
Okay.
We do have a motion and a second. Are there any discussion items or questions among the commissioners? Hearing none, we'll call for the question. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Mr. Sproul is with us tonight. Congratulations to you, sir. I know you'll do a good job.
And if you don't, I'm going to get you.
I'm sorry. The wrath of her, the wrath of them. Thank you, Linda.
Mm-hmm.
Item number eight is a follow-up of a discussion that was introduced at the last meeting to align the hours of the operation for May Memorial Library with the other hours in our county operations, which includes the library in Graham and the library in Mebane. We had some discussion about this. MJ was here at the last meeting. I understand she has a conflict tonight. Ask our county manager, Mr. Honeycutt, to continue this discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As the board's aware, we have cut back positions at May Memorial. Approximately four positions have been cut over the past couple of years, and that has really put a strain on staff to keep the hours open, which they are. And the original discussion we had, instead of either adding staff or making them full-time positions, was to cut the hours back. And the board at that time said, let's look at other options. There was an option we also looked at to leave, just cutting 7 hours and leaving it open till 9 o'clock, or on, excuse me, to 8 o'clock Monday through Wednesday. And that would be $44,000 for those positions. But this is also to help out at Graham. And we have an option to cut the hours back. And we also have an option, we can leave it as is, but we'd have to cut back the programming at the libraries. So the discussion was, if we wanted to keep the service level the same, keep the hours the same, it may, what would it take? And we looked at option one, which would be adding some reclassifications from part-time to full-time, and also putting a couple of part-time positions in. And the total on that would be $62,698.
Why wasn't this taken care of in the budget?
We were cutting back positions in the budget, and we thought we were going to be able to deal with the existing staff and work with the existing staff. She's had about 4 frozen positions, and we cut those frozen positions out. We tried to make it work, but it became very difficult.
I have gotten, thank you, Craig, some...
Heather Hall is also here if there's anything specific or that I missed. So.
I've heard from different groups about the need and desire to maintain the current hours open until 9 o'clock in downtown Burlington, including several groups that have programs that go, I guess, until like 8:30 or so. Strong feeling about that. I also want to say that Commissioner Sutton is on the Library Committee, and as I mentioned earlier, he's not here tonight, but I did talk with him, as I believe Mr. Honeycutt did, and he expressed concern when this issue was brought up last time about cutting the hours and cutting the service. We actually looked at this a couple of years ago and did not make adjustments at that time, and he is he asked me to convey to the board that he is very supportive of maintaining the hours, which you see there as option one, which would be adding, I guess, 75 hours back,
right,
and aligning the hours to be the same. So he he did not want to hold up the process and have everybody wondering, particularly the folks that are involved in the programs now, if the library hours were going to change, which would be another, I guess, 3 weeks before we talk again. So he did convey that sentiment. Entertain a motion to allow the hours under option one, as Craig has outlined, to add 75 hours of staffing and maintain the current hours. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Is there a second? Any other discussion? Any questions for Heather? Anything you want to add?
Not at this time. Happy to answer questions.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Next item on the agenda, the updated recommendation concerning new cars for the Sheriff's Office. I'm going to ask County Manager Craig Honeycutt to begin this discussion.
At our last meeting, we had a lot of discussion about what to do with Sheriff's vehicles. As the board's fully aware, with the budget cutbacks that we have had, we have not funded capital in the Sheriff's Department for approximately 4 years. The funding that he has had for new cars have come from the drug forfeiture funds that have been frozen. So right now, we don't have an avenue to purchase and replace new vehicles. We asked, the sheriff and I have been working together on this for a couple of weeks now, and what we've kind of come up with is there is a need for approximately 30 cars. And the thought process is kind of to spread this out of a 2-year period. We would be looking at the possibility of 20 in this budget year. The cost for each car is approximately $30,000 per car. That would be full package of equipment, lights, paint, new vehicle. But we were looking at a package of 30. Then next year, we would add 10 to the budget. And one of the things that we need to get back into, and I think it was done before we had all the budget issues, there's a schedule of recycling and replacing of cars. So the thought process now in working with the sheriff is to replace 20 in this budget year, 10 next year, 10 the next, 10 the next, and then 20 the next year. So we would, every fourth year, we would get 20 cars and then get 10 years in between.
How many cars are in the fleet total?
We got 140 some cars.
You know, this board cannot tell the board in 3 or 4 years what to do. I mean, we can't obligate them. We can only obligate this year. So when are these cars supposed to appear? I mean, you said this budget year. When's he supposed to get them?
Well, I can tell you, Mr. Smith, we need to get them soon. I mean, we've gone several years without them, and our fleet's getting in pretty bad shape. And I have responsibility to make sure that my people, when they come to work,
sure,
they go home.
Let me ask you only so on. Listening audience can hear you also.
I have responsibility, Sheriff. Number one is when my people come to work, that they go home safe. And we're hitting a period in the sheriff's office right now, like I say, we've met with the county manager, where some of our vehicles are no longer safe. Secondly, I have responsibility when people call with emergency traffic needing service to their home, that we go and able to get there and serve the public like we're supposed to. Like I said, I've talked to Mr. Honeycutt. You know, as soon as we can get 20 cars, we need 20 cars. I'm not going to beat around the bush on it. I can live, and we've talked with 10 cars or 11 cars, 10 cars every year for 2 years after that, and I think the fourth year go for another 20. And we'll see how that goes. But I can tell you right now, we're at the emergency point of possibly wind up losing some more officers in wrecks and stuff because of the conditions of some of the vehicles. I called Elderton Dodge today, Mike Collins, who they have the state contract. All they've got left right now is 19 cars that Dodge Chargers, white in color, that we need. They've got 19, all they've got on the lot. He says it will be 60 to 90 days before the 2014s comes out. And if we can't order, say if we don't order, say December, if we order, it's going to be April for those cars or May for those cars get in here. So I sure would like to see what we can do. And like I say, 20 cars would certainly help us tremendously to be able to maintain the safety of our officers and responding to the public needs as far as calls to service.
I don't see any recommendation on here. I just see a bunch of figures. When are we supposed to get these 20 cars?
Well, what we were looking at is if the board was agreeable to the 20 cars, and again, that's about a $600,000 capital outlay. There's options that we could look at, you know, and I know, you know, Commissioner Smith, you have concern with our fund balance. You know, we do have money set aside in contingency this year of about $940,000. We could take it from contingency. We could look at financing. We did look at the lease option. The lease option was about 5.6%. A direct placement, just borrowing the money straight out over a four-year period, is about 1.6%. We would bid that out, but that was a preliminary cost that we got.
Well, the problem I have is a man needs cars. These troopers are out there having to drive 80, 90, 100 miles an hour sometimes. How far is it from Caswell to Chatham County, Sheriff, that you cover?
Well, I can tell you, if you go to the far end of, from Caswell County to far end south, you're looking at, you know, we got 428 square miles in this county, but at probably 75 miles an hour, you're looking at least 45 minutes to an hour to get one end of the county to the other coming through, because we have to come through Graham.
going that way. And I'll just be honest with you, there's times when all our units are tied up and somebody has to come from that area to go south. And probably that's where the problem comes in as far as danger to our officers driving cars with high mileage and metal fatigue on those vehicles at high rates of speed.
Well, I have a problem with hitting the fund balance with $600,000. I'll tell you that right up front. That was one of the problems the county had in the past, was hitting the fund balance to make up for other things that were not projected very well. And I have a suggestion, and that is that we take $150,000 from the health department slush fund and lease 20 cars right now. And at the in the next budget, we set up 10 or 12 cars a year. That's something you, Sheriff, are going to have to put in your budget for each year, because
well, I put cars in budgets every year.
This board cannot obligate the board in 3 years for 20 more cars. There's no way we can do it. It's a great idea, but the board at that time says no.
Craig, when do you expect to have the audit for this fiscal year just ended in June?
We should hopefully have it end of October, first part of November.
Yeah, I mean, we should have some preliminary figures the end of October, but actual presenting the audit, it'll probably be maybe the end of November.
Craig, did we not have it in our fund? And don't we not have that much in the fund balance?
We, again, if we look at the money we have, we set aside, we put some money in contingency, we put money into fund balance, you know, to a fund balance reserve. We also, you know, with the longevity, we moved that money back into contingency. So that total contingency amount right now is $940,000.
I'd rather take it from there than take it to the health department.
And you got about 596,000 sitting in a budgeted surplus,
right?
Which is the same kind of as contingency.
Right.
So,
well, I would rather take it from one of those than take it from one of the departments, because they don't ever know what they're going to need, you know, especially in the health department. I mean, we could have an outbreak of flu or whatever and not have the money to pay for it. So if I mean, I will vote to take it from one of those, but I can't vote to take it from the health department.
Let me ask a question on your scenario here, Craig, or the sheriff. You've got a leasing option of 10 vehicles annually, purchase of 20, or purchase 10 using a conventional loan. Now, could we not purchase 20 using a conventional loan?
We could purchase 20 using a conventional loan. Really, the difference between a lease and a conventional loan is when you do it under a lease package, it'll come put together already. And you're paying for that convenience of the lights and the radios and everything put together in one package in the cars, you know. If we do a conventional loan, then that's something we'll have to be responsible for, all the installation. So we can do a conventional loan. That does not require LGC approval.
Can we commit?
The original thought process maybe would be to finance 10 cars and to pay cash for 10 cars. If we wanted to do something, you know, immediate. And again, cash-wise, we would need to wait till we get the preliminary numbers back on this year for our fund balance. But we should be adding funds back to fund balance this year, fairly substantial.
Can we separate the decision to commit the vehicles versus how we pay for them?
Yes.
Well, I thought we could until you said under leasing it's a package deal and they come all with the bells and whistles already on. Is that what I heard you say?
I don't know if I understood your question.
You said under the leasing plan, that out of convenience, they come fully.
Right.
Okay, but what if it's a conventional loan, how do they come?
You just buy your cars and you buy your radios, then you transfer it, you buy your lights, and then you have those installed.
Which is the cheapest?
You pay for the convenience under the lease. Is that fair to say, Sheriff?
I think that's correct, sir.
If how many cars does Ilderton have?
Do I know?
How many cars is the older than that? 19?
They have 19. What they have, 2013's left on their lot. They have not started manufacturing 2014's, and it says when they get the orders, then they will call them in. You're looking at 60, 90 days till shipped.
Okay.
Well, leasing is actually buying. I mean, you pay a dollar at the end of the lease period, and they're your cars. So it's the same thing, and you don't have to come up with $600,000 right off the bat. All you got to come up with is $116,000 right off the bat, and that's every year for 5 years. Why in the world we want to pay $600,000 now for them, and when we can get them for $116,000?
Craig, has your staff done an analysis on which financing means would be less expensive in the long run?
In the long run, we looked at just a direct placement, the financing at 1.6%. The total would be $19,200 as far as your financing. Wait a minute, I'm sorry. That was under the 10, so the financing would be $38,000.
Now, we don't have that information here. Is that right?
Well, I'm just adding the you take the bottom one over 4 years, double that, because we were going to finance 10 cars or purchase 10 cars, that would be $38,000.
Oh, you're just doubling it?
Yeah.
Okay.
And if you look at the top one, was just a sole lease lease of cars, it would be $734,000.
Okay, I'm still confused about.
So it would be $638,000 under conventional loan and $734,000 for a lease.
And on our sheet here, it says 1.6%. A minute ago, you said something higher.
I'm sorry, but it is 1.6. That was the quote that we did receive.
Okay, but we would put this out. We would put this out to
right,
bid.
Right.
So, how long does the bid process take for a group of vehicles if it's on a conventional loan? 30 days?
Probably about 30 days.
We don't have 30 days. Man needs his cars now.
One thing to keep in mind, if you purchased them straight out, which is, say, the second option, yes, it'll be $600,000 up front. We've got money in contingency. We've got money in that budgeted surplus, a total of $1.5 million combined. Now, for the next few years, $300,000 in the next few years. Right now, we've got $400,000 budgeted for contingency. If you wanted to transfer, like say in the next year's $300,000 of that into the sheriff's line item, you still wouldn't be looking at a tax increase. You wouldn't have to worry about a tax increase. Yes, that would cut your contingency down to $100,000, but the money would still be there in the budget for the future years. You would just be transferring it from contingency into capital for the sheriff's department, the $300,000. For the next few years. So you would not be hitting your fund balance there because you got $400,000 budgeted in the current year already for contingency. We would just be reducing that. Right. I mean, that's just a thought. If you're concerned about maybe having to raise the tax rate for the capital in future years, we wouldn't have to do that. And as far as the $600,000 now, I mean, that money is sitting in contingency. We have about $946,000 in contingency. We've got about close to $600,000 sitting in budgeted surplus, which either one of those could be transferred right now to the sheriff's department to purchase those vehicles.
And Amy, you're not counting whatever increase in fund balance we may have.
That's correct.
From the fiscal year.
I'm talking about just what's in the current year. And then, I mean, you would avoid closing costs, interest payments.
I think that might be the way to go.
Well, so Amy and Craig, given that, do you have a staff recommendation?
We were looking at a couple different options, but if we will, we can afford to do it out of current year budget. We were originally going to ask to wait until the audited figures came back on our fund balance and then let you make a decision of that. But again, it's 6 of 1, half a dozen of the other. You know, if we ever needed money, you know, $600,000 from fund balance, you can still transfer it at a later date. So it would be 6 of 1, half a dozen of the other.
Sheriff,
yes, sir.
If you get 19 vehicles in what, November, December, that's when they would come in.
Mm-hmm.
What would you do with your oldest 19 vehicles that you have in your fleet?
Well, they'll go to other agencies in the county. You know, we've been handing cars down ever since I've been sheriff to like social services, recreation, etc.
Well, then, what do they do with the cars they have now?
Usually rotate them out. They'll sell whatever's absolute worst.
That's my question. Yeah. So we will get.
Don't even run.
We don't give them away.
Usually they'll gut a deal, whatever the absolute worst cars in their fleet are. And so we'll see some return. It's usually pretty small per car.
But whatever it is could go back into the fund that we're taking these out of, whether it's contingency or fund balance or whatever.
Right. It could.
Yes.
And again, the sheriff just gave us a preliminary budget of $30,000 per car, and hopefully it'll come in less than that as well.
Well, I make a motion we get the sheriff 19 cars. However you can get it.
From current?
Buy them or release them or what?
Whatever is more feasible.
Buy them from current year budget, it would be quicker. And you know, again, there's money set aside contingency, there's money set aside in fund balance, or, you know, that we budgeted
for fund balance surplus. That's what I was thinking. Exactly.
19 is what Commissioner Massey said. Is that the number that's available?
That's what the man has on the lot that we could take possession of as soon as we can get them.
So the motion is to purchase the cars outright, 19 vehicles. Is there a second?
Second.
That would be $270,000 that we would take. Is that right? Okay. Transfer that from contingency to his capital line item.
That's
all
your right. Motion.
We have a motion. Yes.
That's your
second.
Motion. Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other discussion, Sheriff? Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good.
Thank y'all very, very much. I appreciate that.
Excuse me. $570,000. I'm sorry, mom. I should not think on the fly. $570,000.
Well, what you probably need to do is reconcile those numbers and bring us a master report.
Okay, so. We will.
Do you have a county manager's report tonight?
No, sir.
Okay. Are there any other commissioner comments? Not. Stand adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.